Hi, today we're talking to Andrea. Andrea is a speech and language therapist who holds a master's degree in neuroscience and education from Columbia University in New York City. Additionally, she has a master's degree in human communication disorders from Universidad de las Americas in Mexico City. Andrea has worked as a teacher, a speech, language, and learning therapist. She also has researched the importance of early literacy in language development and school readiness. Currently, she resides in Berlin, Germany, where she lives with her loving husband and adorable son. After taking a two-year pause from her professional life to be with her family, she has just been offered a job as a teacher. Welcome, Andrea, and thank you for joining me today. First of all, would you like to tell me a little bit about your own motherhood journey?
Sure, yeah. So, I mean, I can start by telling you that I was very excited when I was pregnant. I started to make, you know, big plans for my baby. My husband and I were reading a lot of books. We had the room already. We took a great birthing course. So we definitely felt that we were prepared. We were ready for this. And then, my baby was born. And I kind of like knew, oh my gosh, I am absolutely, at least that's what I felt. I'm absolutely not at all prepared for this. The first few months were very, very trying months. I felt very tired all the time. I guess one of the easy parts for me was that I was absolutely in love with my baby. So even though I was very tired, he gave me a lot of strength. For me, that was very easy. However, there was a point when I absolutely felt like I was beginning to collapse. I was definitely so sleep deprived. That was a very, very tough moment. For me at that time. And that's when I realized that, I had to do something about this. I found the Little Ones program, and it gave me really quick results. My baby currently sleeps for 12 uninterrupted hours. And I actually think that made me a better mother, that for one. But I also think that, as a result of that easygoing child, he's just really fun to be around. He's like mostly in a good mood. It just made being a mom very enjoyable. And then
Everyone always copes better when everyone sleeps well, right? So that, of course, is going to make everyone a lot happier and able to enjoy the experience.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, even though to this day, I feel like nothing can really prepare you. I mean, there are definitely some great things that you can, in a way, handle much better once you are a bit more rested.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. So, you're a speech and language therapist. So what does this entail?
So as a speech language therapist, I work with children who have either speech difficulties or language difficulties, or it could also be both. So I want to start by maybe dividing them. So I think it's going to be more clear this way. Speech difficulties are, for example, when a child has problems expressing or producing certain sounds in their mother tongue. So could be like in English, for example, instead of saying cat, they will say tat. Changing the k sound for a t sound. So for example, they can also omit certain sounds. For example, instead of saying car, they can just say ka, like omitting the last sound.
Right.
So yeah, in this case, then the clarity of speech is definitely affected. So that's what you would work on in therapy, just trying to improve, you know, the clarity of speech so that other people can then understand them. Then moving on to language. Language difficulties can be when a child has either problems understanding, for example, understanding directions. So this is known as receptive language, or also expressing their needs, maybe an anecdote. This is known as expressive language. So then, of course, as a therapist, you would need to evaluate if you would need to work in either receptive or expressive language, as well as maybe conduct an evaluation where you are determining if the child has problems in the sub areas of language, which could be, like, for example, the meaning, the structure, and the use of language. So, for example, just meaning can be like working with a child by helping him increase his vocabulary. You know, sometimes that is really important. The structure could be helping them simply understand the grammatical structures of their mother tongue.
Right.
And the use has to do more with like nonverbal cues, like really important things like making eye contact when you talk to someone, taking turns when there is more than one person talking, other nonverbal things like maybe understanding jokes, understanding sarcasm, for example. So that is the use of language. Yeah.
That's
so
amazing.
Yeah, I mean, many things that could be definitely stimulated in language. As I said at the beginning, sometimes children can have just speech difficulties, sometimes just language difficulties. Sometimes therapy can entail a combination of both speech and language problems. You know, if parents feel like maybe there is something that, or if your child, you feel like your child is not meeting particular language milestones, it is definitely advisable that you talk to a doctor, to a language specialist, but always keeping in mind that all children develop at a different speed, you know, like never in a way getting too nervous, if like never comparing your child to another child. Definitely a language specialist will help you determine if there is any need of this speech language therapy.
Yeah, I think if any parent is ever worried, my motto is always sort of just go to the professionals, and you can never be like, you might think you're silly, but you know, you can always get reassured by the professional that, you know, it might just be normal, or maybe there is something that you need to look into. So I don't know, I'm just always of the opinion that what's the harm in going and getting it checked out if needed. So
right, of course. There's a lot of information nowadays that you can also access. So of course, like, trust your instincts. If you ever, like, if you have read something like, oh, like maybe my child should be producing maybe a couple words by now, you know, like, and it's not happening, I also believe that. I mean, what's the problem in asking a specialist?
Yeah, exactly. So are there physical barriers that parents should be aware of that might be affecting their speech, for example, like lip or tongue ties, and how does this affect their speech development?
Right. So I want to start off this answer by explaining a little bit about the importance of our oral and face structures, as well as the muscles around the mouth. These are actually very important structures for speech development, right? So if a child has, for example, a lip or a tongue tie, they could definitely affect speech articulation. A tongue tie is when the child is born with a very tight or very short frenulum. This is the membrane that holds the tongue to the floor of the mouth. So like right here, if you put your finger, you would feel it. And then the problem is by having this membrane too tight, it's gonna obviously affect the mobility of all these oral structures of the muscles that are definitely very important for producing certain phonemes, as I was saying at the beginning, right? A lip tie, and it's very similar. So now the affected part is in the upper lip. Mm-hmm. It's also in this membrane, yeah, kind of connecting your gum, mm-hmm, to your teeth. And again, it's gonna impede the correct mobility of all these oral structures, your muscles. So again, impeding correct language articulation. So the good news about this is that if a child has a problem like this, most likely the mother will notice this during his first few months, like as a newborn, basically. Usually mothers report that their child are having is having problems of breastfeeding, for example. So then, of course, like a specialist would have to check what are the probable causes of this. So once the doctor detects this, it could either be that a very, very small cut is done to this membrane that I described, and then this will allow the child to have the correct mobility. Mm-hmm. And most likely they will just continue developing their speech as normal. Other times this really small surgery is not needed absolutely at all. It could just be that the doctor refers the child, even as a newborn, to a speech therapist, where the speech therapist could do certain exercises that helps again just like release the tightness of the membrane. Yeah. So right. Then basically, yes, to answer the question, yes, all of these physical structures are very important for a correct speech development.
Great. And what would happen if, for example, they didn't get detected from feeding or from when their baby was a newborn? What would happen then if the child did go on to grow older and couldn't speak as well? Could the surgery be done then, or is it too late, or what would happen?
No, I mean, it's never too late. Definitely the earliest the intervention, the better, right? But I mean, it could still for sure happen. And then most likely if the child is now speaking, the parents would most likely notice that there are, I guess, as I had said, certain sounds that they're not producing really well. So then speech therapy would definitely work very well, where the speech therapist would have to work with the child, teaching him a few strategies on how to produce certain sounds. Yeah, but right. It's definitely never too late.
good. So going along from that, can dummies or pacifiers or thumb sucking also affect speech and language development?
I would definitely agree with this. As we had mentioned, all these oral structures, the muscles near our mouth are very, very important for a proper speech development. So really my advice would be that during the first few months, a child can definitely use a pacifier. Sometimes, yeah, they suck their thumbs, and that's okay. It's self-soothing. But I would definitely advise parents not to let this go past the age of one. So this is during the child's first birthday, is usually when a lot of oral structures begin to prepare for speech production. So of course, then dummies could definitely influence, you know, like the correct development of these oral structures. So again, I would advise parents maybe to start weaning off the child maybe around 6 months, so that once they are one, they're definitely off the pacifier.
Yeah.
Of course, I mean, it's difficult, but I guess what I could suggest is that try to maybe distract the child, like compensate by doing other activities, you know, like, so maybe when the child wants the pacifier, like suggest, let's read a book, or let's play with your favorite toy, you know, like from personal experience, for example, my child actually never used a pacifier. But when I was weaning off the midday milk bottle, that was difficult. But gradually, like we always used to suggest, let's play with your favorite toy, like let's read one of your favorite books, you know. So like it's just like any habit, you know, like breaking habits are tough. So like, but we were very, very consistent. I think that's the key. We decided we're gonna take away the bottle, the midday bottle. Just be very consistent, and just like any habit, like gradually, if you're consistent, it's definitely gonna break.
Yeah, definitely. I can see how speech and language development does definitely get affected when children or babies have a physical like dummy in their mouth, just walking around during the day. For, you know, like for example, my first child did have a dummy, but she was only ever allowed it for sleep. That was it. She wasn't allowed it during the day. And then the dummy fairy came. And actually, as soon as we took away her dummy, her teeth and her palate changed shape almost immediately, just from not having it. We have two good friends who are both dentists, and they were saying to make sure that it was gone. And hopefully that her mouth shape would change just as soon as it was gone. And it did. And my other daughter actually had sucked her thumb. And that's obviously a lot harder, but she luckily for us, she sucked her thumb, but only would suck it when she was holding her comforter. So the comforter fairy came, and then the same thing happened. Her palate has come down, her teeth, she would suck it on the side, so her teeth were going out sort of to one side, and that's all straightened up. And it's amazing the difference that just a physical thing inside their mouth can change the shape of their mouth so much. And I can see how that can easily affect speech development and speech.
Right. I mean, think of these are, you know, like these structures and muscles, well, like they are like any other muscle, for example. So like, if you want to work out your abs, you go to the gym, you work out, and then you have a result, right? After maybe a few months, you have a change, a physical change. So it's very similar. Like these are muscles that are being affected by, you know, like something that, so the child is sucking on either the dummy or their thumb. So then this will also change their physical structures.